So to answer your question, can I connect two different Microsoft Office applications, PowerPoint and Excel? The short answer is yes, I can do that. Let me show you how. By now, all of us are comfortable with the developer tab, so I open an Excel file. My screen is also being shared. No, wait, I'll share it. You can see the screen, right? All of you?
Yes,
Yes, sir,
sir.
it's visible. Okay, great. So we have enabled the developer tab. I click on Visual Basic. Now let's understand what is happening. VBA, remember, is separate for Excel, PowerPoint, Word. That means I wouldn't call it the backbone, but the VBA component is. I'm sorry, I could not get that. What did you say? All right. So I wouldn't say the backbone because it's not that VBA is the only thing that MS Office works on. As you have seen, they are shifting to TypeScript now. But VBA definitely is a common element. But you have to enable it separately for all the MS Office applications. By default, they don't interface with each other. So PowerPoint, Excel, Outlook, and Word remain separate to each other. Let's see how you connect them. So you go to Tools, and then you have Options. Oh, sorry, References. So what we're doing is we want to tell our system that I want to connect Excel VBA with certain other elements that are available to me. For example, do you see this? We have Solver, which all of us would have worked on at some point of time. I can connect it to Microsoft Forms. I can connect it to proper VB script, which is Visual Basic Script. And if you keep on scrolling down, you will notice there's a lot of stuff here, right? Most of it would not make any sense to you. But at the very least, you know that, oh, there is a lot of stuff that VBA can connect to, but by default, it is not connected. If I keep on scrolling, you notice that there are a lot of Microsoft add-ins. Do you see this? And if I keep on scrolling a little more, you would notice that we have Microsoft Office, different things like screen recording and all. Let me not select something accidentally. Microsoft OneNote, Outlook, and obviously, you will also find Microsoft PowerPoint. Do you see this? The tick mark is not there. This means that by default, if you don't enable it, then it will not link to PowerPoint. So you can't send something from Excel to PowerPoint, even if it's a simple transfer, like copying a value and putting it on PowerPoint. Control C, Control V. It is not possible unless you select this. Simply selecting it will not help you. What we are doing here is we are creating what we call a early binding, which means we are binding the two applications together, right? But now in VBA development, it's a choice that a developer has to make, which is whether they want to do an early binding versus late binding. Now, obviously, this is not just related to VBA. This is a programming concept. Very simple. The binding basically means that you have to explicitly bind two things. You have to make sure the program understands that two things are connected. Early means that I manually click on that tick box and I say that they are linked, or I do a late binding, which means that I don't have to click on that tick box, but I write in the code that it has to be connected to PowerPoint. What is the advantage? Early binding has a lot of performance improvement, right? That's the thumb rule. The benefit of a late binding is that if I share the code with somebody who has not done the early binding, the code will still work on their computer. Think about it. I'm the author. I write a code on my computer. I have done the early binding. I've connected Excel and PowerPoint, which works perfectly. Then I send it to you, but you don't have the early binding enabled. Now, either I tell you to do it on your system, which doesn't make sense if there are 10 of you, or I can do a late binding in the code, which means that I can link Excel and PowerPoint together on my system, and I can share it with other people, and they don't need to bother with what is binding, what do we have to enable. They just click and it runs. Okay. So that's one thing that you have to keep in mind. If you're looking at Excel VBA PowerPoint integration, do you see this? Build your charts in Excel. Let's see how it works. I'll just give you the broad outline. All right. This is a very good article on chandu.org. Chandu, incidentally, is in the top 50 Excel websites in the world, right? He's a guy called Purna Dugirala from Hyderabad, who is now settled in New Zealand. He, I think, was working with Infosys, TCS, some company. And then he was always working on Excel. And then he, of course, is a very senior developer, now very well respected, and one of the top 50 Excel developers in the world, right? Purna Dugirala. Definitely somebody you should follow. Purna Dugirala. Right? This guy. Let me just show his photo. This guy. Right? Okay. Now let's see what he has done. Do you see this? You have to first add the PowerPoint library like this. I'm not sure if he has covered the lead binding or not, but anyway, let's see what he's doing. I also haven't seen this for a while. So see, you're first activating the app, app activate Microsoft PowerPoint. That means you're telling Excel that you want to activate an app in the background. You're not literally opening it, but you're activating it, right? So let's look at what he has done. Just a minute. Let's see the download that he has. Okay, that doesn't seem to open. Let me try something else. Just give me a moment. Declare variables, open from. Okay, let's copy this. Let's go to Excel. I want to enable it. Okay, do it right in front of you. So tools, references, we go to PowerPoint. And we enable that. So PowerPoint. Okay, so we enable that. All right, then we paste the code. Let's see what the code is doing. Okay, this will also be good learning for all of you. I know we are switching between different topics, but I mean, you have to, you can't just work on one thing at a time, right? Let me just clean it up a little bit so you can understand. Everyone, first we're declaring the variables. So PP is PowerPoint application, PP press is PowerPoint presentation, PP slide is PowerPoint slide. So that is the object hierarchy. Most of you would know what an object model looks like. That is what we're doing here, right? Object-oriented programming, which means the first hierarchical level is the application. The application has a presentation and the presentation has a slide, all right? Okay, once we've done that, we will set PP is equal to new PowerPoint.application. New basically will open a new application, new PowerPoint application. Then we are dot add. Dot add means we are adding a new presentation. Please remember there's a difference. Opening the application doesn't open an actual sheet or a presentation. Please understand. When I click on PowerPoint, this is the application that is opening, okay? But when I click on blank presentation, I'm opening the presentation. So I hope all of you note the difference between these two. After that, we are saying add new slide to slide one and set the focus to it. That means that should be the active slide. So PP slide is equal to slide add one, okay? Then this is the type of the slide, which is PP layout, title only. Most of you will know that there are different types of layouts available. Let's quickly look at that. So when you click on any blank slide, you notice that there are different types of layouts available. So we have title, title and content, title only, comparison, like this. These nine are the default. You can get many more like this. So that's what we're doing. We are basically setting it as PP layout, title only, the very first one. Then we select that slide. Then we copy the range as a picture, which is slide data. Now remember this sheet name should be slide data. So I'll come back and I'll make sure that this is sheet one. So I'll just come here and make that change here and call this sheet one. What range do we want? I'll just select from A1 to A10. Let's just write some numbers here, okay? So let me just write sequence 10, right? That should give me 10 numbers. Then I want to paste the picture and adjust the position. Let's not get into the alignment, but I think this is very clear, center, middle alignment. You want to give a title to the slide, and then you want to basically short shapes, title, text frame, text range dot text, that is the text that you're giving. After that, you're activating it and you're cleaning up the memory because there's a lot of things saved in cache, right? Because it's saved, how should I put it? You can't see these things happening, but they're saved in the cache. So you want to clear the clipboard. That is why you have to say equal to nothing, nothing, nothing. You want to clear the clipboard, right? Clear the memory. Let's see if it works or not. Let me first close my PowerPoint. Yeah, I don't see a reason why this shouldn't work. Let's see. So we have an Excel, everyone. Let's go to developer macros. This one. Run. Cool, right? So this is the basic structure. After this, you do what you want, the color, the alignment of the image and stuff like that. Does it answer your question?
Yes, sir. So we can basically record a macro there in the...
No, you can't record it. How can you record it?
I can't record it.
No. Life isn't that simple. So I think let's do that. We're still left with the recording bit. I think let's do Tableau in the second half. Let's just recap what I showed you. You enable developer. You can copy codes from the internet and you can paste it. Remember, we did table of content, unhiding all the sheets. There is something very peculiar in Excel, which is that whenever you perform an action, Excel gives you the ability of recording that action. That means, okay, if I am on a cell, okay, and I write 100, currently nothing is recorded because no action has happened. Till the moment I press enter, it will not record an action. When I go right arrow, action, left arrow, action. Control B is an action. Zooming in is an action. Making a new sheet is an action. Deleting a sheet is an action. Selecting the column is an action. Cut and paste is an action. So basically these are all actions that you're performing. How do we record it? Very simple. Two ways of doing it. Either here, record macro, or at the bottom left corner, record macro, exactly the same thing. Let me select this one. It asks us for a name. Let's just call it test. Never ever should you give a shortcut like Control C. I think I already mentioned this, but I'll say it once again. If you write Control C and you run the macro, your existing Control C will stop working. Furthermore, on MS Office, on Excel at the very least, you will not be able to use Control C for copy. This overwrites and makes a registry change. So while this might seem like a very simple thing, it's making a very big change. Of course, you can turn it back, but that's another battle that you have to fight. So please make sure never to do it. The standard nomenclature that we follow is that whenever there's a coder, we have to give a shortcut key. We always give it in combination with Shift. For example, Control Shift C. The reason is because Control Shift C is not an inbuilt shortcut for anything. Now, certain Control Shift do work, like Control Shift P is something, but that's okay. Control Shift C, Control Shift V is okay. Then the description is just something for yourself. We'll leave it blank. And then it is asking us, do you want to save the macro in the current workbook or in something called a personal macro workbook? As the name suggests, the personal macro workbook is a file saved somewhere in the Microsoft C directory, in the application folder, right? Where it has been installed, the installed folder. You can't see it. What is a personal macro workbook? The personal macro workbook is basically one workbook in which if you save a code, it will run on all your Excel files. That means you can access it from all your Excel files. What do you think? Is it a good idea? Yes or no? Is it a good idea to keep my code restricted to the current workbook? Or should I keep it in a personal workbook so that I can use the code on any Excel file on my computer? What do you think?
The second option.
It seems now that why would you want to copy and paste the code every time you want to use it in a different file? This is super, super, super dangerous. Why? Simple. If you save a code in the personal macro workbook, you're basically giving it access to every single file on your computer. So if something malicious is there, like let's say I copy something from the internet and there is something malicious, it does something bad. Or inadvertently, you do something which you were not supposed to do. You were supposed to delete one sheet, you accidentally deleted all the sheets. Irreversible changes, and they can happen on every workbook on your computer. I don't really see any advantage in using personal macro workbook. Now you might say, but Habish, what if you want to use a macro in all your Excel files? Sure, I mean, that might be a requirement. But if that is a requirement, I can create a tab like this, Havisham Consulting. Personal macro workbook, believe me, is not worth the effort. I'm telling you so that you know, but don't do it. just don't. Especially as a novice programmer, you should never do it. Very experienced programmers probably can. I can afford to use it with caution. You should never ever do this, right? Please just take my word for it. So basically, I'm not changing anything. I'm not giving a shortcut key, which we don't need. The macro is in the current workbook and no description. The moment I press OK, this changes from start to stop recording. And at the bottom, this also changes to stop recording. Here on, whatever I do will be recorded very quietly by VBA in the background. For example, let me select A2 put 200, 300 equal to sum of the three cells. And let me also select it, put a color, and let me put a border. Now, a lot of you must be thinking, it wasn't really a very complicated process. Let's first see if it works or not. Okay, then we'll come to the code. Let me open another sheet. Let me write a number here. I'm sure all of you would expect what will happen. I click on macros, I run test. And if you notice, in one click, instantaneously, it is executing all the things that I did. Now let's look at the code. How many lines of code do you think this would be? Let's count. I went to A2, I put in 200. I went to A3, I put in 300. I went to A4 and I put in a formula, and then I colored it and then I put a border on it. As per my counting, 8 steps, correct? So one would say, fine, 8 lines of code. You want to see how many lines of code this is? Watch. Modules, module 1. This is the code that has been recorded. This is the issue with coding that a lot of people don't realize. To us, it seems we perform 8 steps. What the hell just happened? You have to understand that there are certain codes that might look very long, but you're not actually using every single line there. Let me explain. Let's follow. We selected A2, everyone. Let me highlight it. We selected A2. After that, we put in a number called number 200. It's called active cell.formula R1C1. Please remember, VBA does not work on ABCD 1, 2, 3, 4. It works on row and column as a grid. So fifth row, fifth column, like that. Then I went to A3, and then I went to, I put in a number 300, I went to A4. So far, everything is very simple. Can anybody guess what this is? Application.cut copy mode false. Just think what this can be. Just guess. Anyone, would you like to hazard a guess? This is escape, okay? Application.cutcopy mode false means that, see, when I press Control C, do you see this line is moving? What I call the ant line. What does it mean? Application.cutcopy mode is equal to true. The moment you press escape, it makes it application.cutcopy mode equal to false. Now comes the tricky part. Look at this, let me isolate this. What the hell is happening? I was supposed to write a formula in A4, which is equal to sum of A1 colon A3. But what is happening here? You have to understand that VBA does not record A1 colon A3. VBA records as a relative distance. That means it says that from A4, if I have to go to A1, how many rows do I have to go up? 3 rows. But the C is without a number because I'm on the same column. Where is A3? A3 is one row above A4, and I'm in the same column, which is the C being blank, like this. Any questions on this, anyone? This is very important. How formulas are represented in VBA codes. Makes sense, right? So RC, it means how many rows and columns you're moving left, right, up, down to access the input cells. Then we selected A4. Now look at this. What is this? This is the color that I put. Remember, I put that yellow color, this one. This is what is happening. With selection interior, pattern is solid, pattern color index is automatic, color is 65535, right? This is the border, all of this part. Now, why is the border such a complicated line of code? Because borders are in every direction, no? Top, bottom, left, right. That is the reason you notice it says, this is my top border, this is my bottom border, this is my right border, right? This is my left border, like this. So I hope you're all getting the hang of it, how you record and how it is recorded in the background. But watch, if I copy something, let me start the recording once again. Let's call this test two, all right? Control C, Control N, I'm opening a new workbook and I'm doing Control V and I'm doing paste special as a link. And I'll stop the recording. I can work between multiple Excel workbooks. Let's see what the code has recorded. Do you see this? Let me put it at the top so that you can see this properly. Very simple. It says selection.copy, which means Control C, workbooks.add, that means Control N, I added a new workbook, ActiveSheet.paste, which means Control V, and A2.select, I selected the cell A2, and then I did a ActiveSheet.paste link equal to true. That means I pasted the value as a link. Any questions here? Anyone? Working between multiple Excel files. Right, easy peasy.
One small thing actually. So when you click Control N and we created a new worksheet. So if you are going to workbook, so if you are going to add 2-3 workbooks, like how will it distinguish? Again, if you do workbooks.add, it's going to add another workbook, but when you go to the other workbook, how will it?
You have answered your question, haven't you? So when you sort of say that, can it link to a PowerPoint? It can't. One of the reasons is this, because you can't explicitly tell it which of the workbooks it is. You're absolutely right. Let me do it once again. Please watch everyone. Record macro. Just see what I'm doing. Test three. Okay. Control C. I do Control N. And then I do Control V. I do Control N once again, and I do 200, I'm typing it. Control N once again, and then I'm doing 300. Now I have lots of workbook open. Let's go back to the second one we opened, which is book three. And I want to write 200 here. And I want to stop the recording. Now all that is going to happen is in the code, because now you're working with multiple workbooks, each workbook has a dummy name that is given, book one, book two, book three, before you save it, it is there, see. Copy, add, sheet paste, workbook add, this. But when I come back to workbook three after a point, like I went to 3, 4, 5, then I went back to 3, it says that I activated workbook number 3. But you have to keep a check of all these things. Because the problem is, listen, everyone, the problem is that, how should I explain it? Wait, let me delete, let me close all the workbooks. I only have one workbook open right now. Everyone on my system. This workbook is called book one. When I press Control N, what will be the new workbook that is created? What will it be called? Right now, if I press Control N, what will be the number of that book?
Book four or book five.
Do you know? So you understand what you're saying, right? Because Excel remembers that I've already created a couple of workbooks in the past and I've deleted them. When I press Control N, it creates book six. This basically means you can't record a code because these numbers are not in your control. The numbers will go in a sequence. So the first time you're recording it, it might be 1579, but when you want to read on it, you have no confidence that you want it to be 1579. And these variables are dynamic. So you have to take care of that dynamically. That's what I'm saying. You know, VBS seems very simple. It's just, if you could have recorded everything, then what's the big deal? Also, when you record with a test four and I copy a value, Control C, and I go to PowerPoint and I click inside and I do Control V and I come back and then I stop and I go back to the code window, you notice it just says Control C. The moment you switch from Excel to any other application, even if it is a Microsoft Office application PowerPoint, the recording will not work. Recording can only happen till the moment you are still within Excel. The moment you leave that application and move to a different application, the recording doesn't happen, right? So obviously you have to write the code, whatever comes after that. Right? Anything still left unanswered?
For the thing which I told, can we use something else which will be more suitable for that? Or?
But I did answer that, didn't I? You said you want to take some data from Excel and put it on PowerPoint.
Yeah, but like recording a macro.
You can't record it. The short and the long answer is, the only answer is you can't record it. By the way, PowerPoint does have developer, but there is no record option in PowerPoint. Only Excel has a record option. PowerPoint and Word don't, they have VBA, but they don't have a record option.
I'll just tell you what exactly I'll do. So you just suggest me
You're not going to spend a lot of time on that, but...
Just a minute, it won't take much time. So basically I get a dump of Excel sheet, a CSV file. So whichever region or whichever work, whichever task I have, whatever KPIs I have, accordingly from the Excel sheet, I have to calculate what is the first pull rate or whatever the parameters, a few parameters are there. I have to calculate all those things. I have to make charts for that, bar charts, year on year growth, everything I have to show, and I have to put it in a PPT. This is exactly what I'll have to do every month, once a day. I have to do this for reporting. So for this work,
VBA can't do it. I mean, VBA can't do it using recording. Maybe you can write some code and it can do it, but it will still not be very efficient. There'll be a lot of limitations in it. And as we move along, Microsoft is moving away from VBA. It's moving towards TypeScript. So even if something works today, there is a possibility it might not work 5 years down the line. The most efficient way of doing this is use Python. Python-pptx. You have a library that connects Python with pptx, and you have OpenPyXL, which connects Excel to Python. Once you're in the realm of Python, you can do whatever you want to do, right? This is the only way to do it, OpenPyXL.
Okay,
great. So we've done the record bit, but you know, guys, despite the fact that it might seem to you that I'm telling you, no, this is bad, don't use it, this, that, not the PowerPoint bit, only the Excel bit. Do understand that a lot of profiles and a lot of processes are extremely process driven, in the sense that you get a file, just hear me out. Let's say I have a superstore data. Every Monday morning, I will get a file from SAP like this. What will I do? I will first, this is the data, exactly like this. First, the first thing I'll do is I select data, I'll click on filter. All right. Once I've done that, I will, go to column R and select the sales amount and sort it from largest to smallest. Then I select the first 10 values and I'll color it green. Okay, then I'll copy these 10 values, make a new sheet, right, like this, and then find the average of these 10 values. Everything that I'm doing up till now, this can be recorded and this can be rerun beautifully without any issues whatsoever. You know when the problem comes? The problem comes when you have to make a pivot table, which is like something you're doing 9 out of 10 times, aren't you? And you know why it's a problem? Let me show you. Developer, record macro, okay. I'll just do the pivot bit. When I click on insert, pivot table, okay. I'm not doing anything else. I'll stop the recording now. See what has been recorded. Do you see this, everyone? This is the pivot table. I'm not worried about the length of the code. How does it matter? I know I did a very simple thing. I just did insert pivot, all right? Yeah, but let's see what is happening. So it says active workbook.pivot cache. So you have to understand the background. What happens is, okay, when I make a pivot, after I made a pivot, I can actually delete the source data. And a lot of people say, but there's something wrong. How can you do that? If you delete the source data, then how will you go back and refresh the pivot table? Correct, right? But you notice that when I do refresh it, it works. And then people say, but it doesn't make any sense. You've deleted the source data. What happens is that on Excel, when you make a pivot table, there is an intermediary step, which you don't see. which is called a pivot cache. So the data actually comes into the pivot cache, and from the pivot cache, we make the pivot table. So see this. From the first thing I did was, after I added a sheet, I created a pivot cache, which is from the source data, which is DND R1C1 9995C21, okay? Which means the 9995 row, 21 column. The version and all, ignore it. Then I created a pivot table. So this is the two-step process. First the cache, then the pivot. Where did I create it? On sheet 4, and I called it pivot table 1. That's the problem. The problem is that when you're recording the macro, it will be recorded as a pivot table 1. But when you try to rerun it, it is not, you can't be sure that the new table that you want to create is called by the same name or not. What if that name already exists? Then there'll be a clash. So all of these are dynamic variables that you will have to set every single time. We can all do it, right? And I'll give you an example just now. Yeah. So I'll give you an example just now. Just give me 2 minutes, because this file is actually on my other laptop, but let me see if I can find it on an email. Subhas Sadan Ki. This is not good. Let's see. You know what? I don't think I have it on email. Just a moment. That's okay. I'll share a link with you. You can understand it from there. See, like I said, you can't hold it against me. VBA can't be taught in 2 sessions, 3 sessions. So I'll just tell you how to do it. Pivot table VBM, right? So spreadsheet guru, pass spreadsheets, automate Excel, Excel champs. This is the one. He explains it. He's an Indian guy, explains it very well. I think Sumit Nagpal or something. Explains it very well. So he has given the entire code. Yeah. So you first have to declare the variable. Then you have to insert a new worksheet. After that, you have to define the data range. So all of this is what you can control, you know, the destination sheet. Then you can create a pivot. You have to create a pivot cache. Then you have to create a blank pivot table. Then you have to insert the row and columns. And then you insert the data field. And then you have to format it. So basically the entire code is this, which has been given. You can copy and paste it, but yes, you might have to make a few changes here and there, right? But definitely worth a look. I mean, this is the one you should see. Don't spend time Googling it. A lot of websites will not give you what you need. This is one of the simpler ones. The others will be fairly complicated. And see, what you're asking me is more of a consulting project. You know, it's not that I have a ready answer. Like if you say, sir, I have a data set and I want to automate it. I want to calculate my KPIs and put it on PowerPoint. I'm sure I can do it for you, but this is a project that I'll have to work on, right? But I hope I've given you the bits and pieces so that you know how one would go about it. Certain things are available, certain things you can record, certain things you will have to write, because your specific project is so distinct and so unique that you will not be able to find it on the internet. Right. Anything else related to VBA that anybody can think of? Just take 2 minutes, think about it. So there are mixed feelings, okay, when it comes to VBA. We are excited to work on it. We are excited at the potential that it offers. But yes, it is scary. It's a little drab as well. It's not the most exciting thing in the world. But that's okay. You know, it doesn't need to be exciting for you to have to work on it. If you need to work on it, you need to work on it, right? Great. Let me just show you one more thing on VBA, something very different. I want to create a name and age, let's say, right? So I want to create a database like a pseudo software, which means that I am collecting some data from my customers, and as in when their forms, let's say physical forms or whatever, Google forms come to me, I note down their age and their name, and I prepare a master file here, okay? Now there's a bit of a problem. The problem is, let me just hide everything else so that you are not bothered with it. Okay, now the problem is that, how do you do it? Like, you'll have to type everything, no? Let me create a nice software. Let's see how it works. Please watch, everyone. Developer, Visual Basic, and let's do it from the beginning. We'll first insert a module, which we already know is a place where all the codes are saved, right? But I want to create a form, you know, something interactive. So I will again insert and insert what we call a user form. A user form is just a placeholder where you can keep different objects in it. What do I want to call the user form? I don't want to call it user form one. So I'll just change the caption and make it, let's say, entry form. We also don't like this color, right? This gray color is very boring. So I can just select the back color and make it white. What do we need in it? We need three things, or rather five things. Two labels, two text boxes, and one submit button. Two labels means enter age, enter name. Two text boxes where you enter the age and enter the name, and a submit button. So this is a toolbox that you have. If you don't see this, don't worry. There is a small button here called the toolbox here next to the question mark on the left, right? This will enable it. You have everything that you need here. We have a text box, we have a label, and we have a, where is it? Command button, right? Damn it, where is it? Command button, this one. So I will drag the label. I'll drag the label and the text box. Then I'll do it one more time. Label and the text box. Obviously the colors should be different. So let's just select a different color here. I'll choose a blue and I'll choose a blue. Now, obviously we'll have to change the font color. So let's go to font. And font color is here. Let's change it to white, and this one becomes white. Perfect. Let's call this, so we can just click on it and we can say enter name. We can click here and we can say enter age. So far everything is very simple. I can make a command button also, and I can say submit. Let's keep the color like this only. So this looks great, and let's see how it looks. So I will click on the run button, which is F5, and you can see that this is how the form appears. Very impressive, isn't it? With very little work, you can create such a beautiful form like this. But these have to be connected to the Excel, right? The first problem is, how do I even display the form? That means if I go to developer and macro, you notice there is nothing here. I need to have a macro whose role is to display the form. So what will I do? In my module, what is the name of the form? It's called user form one. So I will say sum show form. And what is the name of the form? I will say user form one dot show, which means it will open it. How does it work? Now I can click on developer macros and I can show the form, show form, and it will show it. But it would be better if there was a button on Excel where I can click on and it will open the form rather than going to macros every time. So this is what I'll do. I will just create a shape, insert shape, and I'll create a nice circle, make a different color in it, right? And we will write inside edit text, we'll say open entry form, right? And you know what? I don't really like the circle, so let me just change it to a. I think that's good. But how will this shape, this is just a shape, nothing special. How will this shape open that form? Interestingly, on a shape, you can assign a macro. That means you can convert the shape into a trigger. So when I connect it to show form, what will happen? This will become a button now. Do you see this? How do you open the form now? You don't have to go to developer and macros and click on show form. The user simply clicks on this. So you're making the process. This is user experience, right? What we're doing right now. Wonderful. But now the value from that text box, which is these two, has to come inside which cell? A2 and B2. But there's a bit of a problem, no? Because if I say that the value comes in A2 and B2, how will the next value come in A3 and B3? Otherwise, it will keep on overwriting. Makes sense, right? So I need to have a dynamic number, which means every time I click on submit, it should first check how many names already appear in my Excel, and it should add a name to the next row. For example, right now, how many rows are already used? Only one, because I have, in fact, let me just add one here so that you can look at the next one, right? Let me just align everything to the left. So when I add another one, it should come on the third row. So this is what we'll do. I will double click on the form, okay? And I will say, when the user form is activated, what do I want to happen? Nothing. So we'll keep it blank for now. In fact, let's not overcomplicate it. Let's keep it simple. I will double click on the submit button. That means when somebody clicks on the command button, what should happen? So the first thing is name should go as a new name, right? And then age should go as a new age. But the problem is, I want to know how many names already exist. Fair enough. How are we going to do that? Think about it. We need something called L call, which is last column. So I need to know that in the column one, remember no A's in VBA, in the column one, how many rows already exist? So L call, L row. We want to find the L row right now. We can Google it. Let's not spend time with me explaining it to you. You can simply say VBA L call, right? Or let's just say last row. That would be easier. Let's open a website. It's just one or two lines of code. Look at this. It says, to find the last row, what do I do? Cells rows.count, one, dot end, Excel up, dot row. I know it seems very complicated. Let me explain it to you. Can somebody tell me that if I wanted to come to the last row, how would I do that in column A? Like using the keyboard, what would you do? I'm sitting on A1. How do I come to the last row?
Control and down key twice.
Okay. Now, a lot of you will say, Havish, you can just do control down. I agree with you. But you know the problem? What if there were blank rows? It's possible, no? Now, will control down work if there are, let's say, I hope all of you can connect to what I'm saying. Control down only works when there are no blank cells. Now, control down will not work. Everyone agrees? Now tell me, what would be a better way of doing it? A correct way of doing it. This doesn't work, right? Control down will not work. Here it will work because there are no blank cells. What if there is a blank cell? It will not work. So what is a more foolproof way of finding the last row?
So we can go to the last row of the Excel sheet and from there control up.
Absolutely. Very good. We go to the last row of the Excel sheet, which is 1048576, which is 1, 1048576. Now understand what is happening. Do you see this? What is rows.count 1048576 and what is 1? It is the column number. That means we're actually saying that let me go to 1048576, 1, which is this, And then I want to do a control up from here. And how do I do a control up? Excelup.row. Right? So I hope you can relate it to the process. A lot of people say, oh, this is just code. I will remember it or write it somewhere. No, don't do that. Understand what is happening. To find the last non-blank cell in column A, which means column 1, what do? You do this. If I want to find the last row in column 2, tell me what will I change in column B? Guys, if I want to find the last row in column B, what do I change here?
Comma 2 can...
Simple. This becomes 2, right? Same thing. You also have a non-blank cell in row 1. This time you do a 1 comma columns dot count and you do an Excel 2 left. That means you're doing control left. That means when you're working on an Excel file and I have some values here, how do I know how many columns have I used? First, I'll go to the last column of my row and then I'll do left arrow with control, right? That will tell me which is the last row. Wonderful. Let's see if it is working or not. Ideally, the answer should be 4, which is what we are interested in. Let's see if it gives me the answer or not. Let me go to the code window and we want to copy this. Right? We are looking in column 1, so everything remains the same. And then I say message box L row. So let's see if it works or not. All right. I'll come back. I'll open the form. I will click on submit. Do you notice it says the third is the last row where there is a value. That means it will be plus 1. That means the next value will come in 4. If it was 7, it will come in 8, right? Okay. So we're getting somewhere. All right. So now I'll say row in which new name should come. What is this row? This will be L row is equal to L row plus 1. Now, again, programming guys would understand this, but for those of you who are confused, what is happening? What I'm doing is I'm incrementing L row by 1. I can even call it L row 2. But that's not considered a good practice. You know why? Because you're unnecessarily creating another variable name. And you will get confused. If you, every time you keep on creating a new variable name, see, after I create L row 2, do I need to know what is L row? No, I don't need it anymore. That is why I need to discontinue it. And I will basically call it L row. So I'm incrementing L row by 1. One of the basics of programming, equal to sign is never an equality. Right? So sign is not for equality. It is for assignment, right? So what am I doing? I'm assigning L row plus 1 to the left-hand side, which is L row. That means if L row is 5, I add 1 to it, it becomes 6. And then I'm taking it to the left-hand side and I'm making it L row 6. Okay. Now, once we have done this, we need to know where the name will come, which means text box 1.text will come in the fourth row and the first column. So I will very simply say text box 1.text is equal to cells, which row and which column. I will say my L row is the row and 1 is the column. I know what the column is. And I will say same thing again. Text box 2.text is equal to L row, and this will be the second column, right? Let's see if it works. So open, let's add a different name. Right? It doesn't work because I did a very silly mistake. It should actually have been the other way around. I'm sorry. We want the value from the text box to come inside the cell, right? Not the other way around. My mistake. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this should be okay now. Come back, open entry form. Let's say enter name, Anmol, 33, submit. The values come here. Now I can enter another value. But the problem is that the message box is still coming. So we don't really need that. So I can hide the message box. That was just for our testing, right? Also, what I want is that after the name is put, the text boxes should become blank. So I will say Xbox one dot text is equal to blank. Same thing, Xbox dot two dot text is equal to blank, which means let's add something here. Submit, the value comes here, and these also become clear, right? I can also say textbox one dot set focus. Just see what it does. Open, write another name, submit, and now do you see what happened? The cursor is automatically moved to the name box. So, you know, so this is the small cues that you can give to the user. See, in an age of mobile applications, we expect as a user, even in a free application, to have everything we want, right? We want extreme fluidity, it should never crash. Everything should look brilliant and easy to use. But when you're actually creating it as a developer, you have to keep all these things in mind, right? So these small things that when somebody enters a name, the text box should become clear so that he doesn't have to delete it. And once that has happened, it should automatically move into the name text box so the user can enter a new one. Small pause here. Anything you would like to ask?
So, sir, we used it to put name and age in an Excel field.
Yeah.
We could have used a Google form for it also, right?
For what?
Getting the name and age of people and then putting in two columns.
I'm very confused. Where does Google form come into the picture suddenly?
So you're telling us how to write VBA script in Excel. But why would I do this in Excel when I have an easier alternative? That's my point.
Companies don't work on Google Forms. No, companies work on Excel. That's why. You go to a finance team, an operations team, or a CEO, CXO of a company and say, what do you do? Do you go to Google Forms? Of course not, right? 499 out of 500 companies will work on Excel. That's why you want to work on Excel. See, I, as a company, will prepare my marketing pricing strategy not on Google Forms. I'll be creating an Excel. Do you agree with that? If I'm in finance and I'm downloading my SAP data, what do I do? Do I download my SAP data and put it on Google Forms and analyze it to build my budget plan? Of course not. I do that on Excel. The reason we are doing it on Excel is not because this is the best way of doing it. On the contrary, this is one of the worst ways of doing it. But I do have no choice. Because Excel is the de facto tool used by everyone. Hence, I have to do as much as possible I can do on Excel, right?
Right, sir.
A company who doesn't work on Excel, there would be very few of them. For them, this has no significance. You're basically giving them a solution to a problem they don't have. My solution is for a problem for a company who says, Harish, I have to do this manually every time. You know, imagine I have 700 names with me. The first thing I do is I go to the last row. I see which is the last name. Then I have to put a value there, right? Okay, let's add something to it. This time I'll record a macro. Let's close this example. And what's the time? Yeah, I think we should also go back to Tableau now.
So, sir, the user form that you showed initially about the HR, where it was about employees and then their strength and their weaknesses, where it was being recorded and it was kind of visual interface in Excel, that made sense. Mm-hmm. But okay, if from HR's perspective, if a manager wants to make it visually appealing and show it to senior managers of HR, then okay, they can click and see it. That made sense, but yeah. So that is an extension of this only. This is just one bit of the whole piece, no?
It's the same thing. What I showed you is exactly what I'm doing right now. The only difference is that here I'm pushing the data, there I was fetching the data. In that example, I already had the data with me. I had to pull it and show it to the user. Like I had the MIS. And I told the user, if you want to see an employee, you select the name and you pull the data. Here I'm saying, I want to create a database. And to create the database is where I'm basically giving the user the option of putting the data that they want to populate their database.
And secondly, for basic functions like an entry form with two fields, do I have to write VBA code every time, or can I get it from Google it and then copy it and then change it?
I mean, you will find some examples that people have prepared, like on some blogs and tutorials and all. But at the end of the day, every Excel file is different. No, everybody's requirement is different. So you, like, what if somebody wants to start on column B? Or what if somebody wants to have column A and C? Or I don't know, what if the second column type is not a number, but it's a text value or it's a date value, something like that. But you can't just, what are you going to Google? Will you Google VBA form to enter name and age? Do you understand what I'm saying?
No, how to make a VBA script to enter two fields.
You tell me, do you really feel that that makes sense? Of course not. Doesn't make any sense. I'll do it for you so that, wait. Tell me, how would you parse this query? How to doesn't really matter. So
VBA script to create two field user form.
Script, always VBA code, okay? Never write VBA script. VBA code to create
two field user form in Excel.
See, you're not finding anything. So you will have a general blog entry. Again, then you suddenly have combo boxes, which we don't really require right now. Then you have a two column combo box, which is something very different. And a Stack Overflow, most of you would know, is for developers. Going to Stack Overflow is basically killing yourself if you don't know what you're doing. You will get utterly lost here, right? This is for hardcore developers, and this is how it looks. People don't put images and all. This is for developers, right? By developers, for developers. See, this is what I wanted to tell you. You can't search for these things. You will not find it. Like multiple units. And what you're saying is not even a generic query, you know, two fields user form. Right? For example, if I say, let me not just tell you that this is not how you do it. Let me tell you what you can do. VBA code to change color of user form. Do you see? Change color of value in user form. Change the color of a user form in VBA. Do you see the difference between your question and my question? My question is a very generic question related to something which I'm sure is there, but I'm not able to find it, or it's a very complicated property, or I don't have the time to search for it. What you're saying is a specific requirement that you have. That way somebody tomorrow will say, I want to create a user form with five fields with two numbers. That is your project requirement. That is not a generic query that you can Google. Do it. I always tell people, don't take my word for it. My word is not gospel. Search for it. The more you search, believe me, that's a huge learning. Today, I'm telling you guys, don't search for it. Don't bother. You will not find anything. But you're not going to always have me on your side. Today, if you spend 2 hours searching different things on Google, you know what that will do? That will give you the learning of a lifetime. How did I know that searching for this will not help you? Because what do you think? I haven't searched for these things online. My 5 years I've spent on doing all of this work. I always tell people I can search for stuff on Google better than other people, especially related to analytics, right? So people say, Harish, I've been searching this on Google for 2 days. I have not been able to find the answer. I search the same query for them on Google, right in front of them, and I get the answer in 2 minutes. And then they say, oh, you must have seen this earlier, or you must know which website it was. I said, I have never heard of that question. This is absolutely new to me. I did not know where to go to. I just know how to frame the question. It's an acquired skill. This is just years of experience and a lot of hard work that has gone into it. There are no shortcuts to this. It's just pure hours. Somebody who invests 100 hours versus 1,000 hours, the guy with 1,000 hours in it will be better at it. You just have to get better at searching on Google. For a data analyst, super, super important. Knowing the right websites, the right blog, how to go to that specific link. You know, I'll give an example. I was doing that convert to INR, remember? From where I converted a number to a rupee. Do you know where I found that that actual solution for Indian rupees? US dollars is available everywhere for Indian rupees. That was an article from, I think, 2001, which I found on some old website, right? And that is the beauty of it. There are such hidden gems available on the internet. You just have to know where to go. Like, there's a guy called Ron De Bruin, one of the leading guys for Excel automation. Look at his website. You tell me that if somebody accidentally bumps into this website, would you even stay here for 2 minutes? You will say, what the hell is this? I mean, this bloke doesn't even have a wide screen. He's still working on 640, 480. This guy is one of the best guys for Excel automation and all that, you know, Outlook integration, PowerPoint integration. Let me show you. I mean, just see his work. He's absolutely brilliant. I mean, anyway, this is just links to Microsoft, but wait. Wait. Okay, I don't know. Maybe I have to go to his blog first. Yep, this is better. So if you notice, this is ages back that he has written all this. But what he has written, it might not seem like a lot, but the depth with which he has written it and the clarity he has, he's one of the best people in the world. That's the problem. Other people who see this website, they will not stick around, right? They will say, oh, you know, there's something wrong with it. I want to press the back button. I will stick. This is one of the best websites for Excel, right? So I hope that helps in terms of what you can search for. See, I'm not trying to dissuade you. I'm just sharing my experiences with you. Don't do it. And I can say this with so much confidence because I know I've been there, okay? I don't preach everywhere, right? I don't always tell you what to do. I'm more than happy to say, you know, this is an area out of my area of expertise. This is an area of my expertise. I spent years working on this. It's not my entire life, but whatever bit of life I have, I've spent on this. So please make sure to look at, hear my words with a lot of patience and stick to it, right? You'll thank me. Wonderful. So good example. I think we have seen how an entry form can be created. And of course, you can keep on adding more and more and more elements on it, like a small thing. When the form is open, you can't select the Excel, which means you can't work on them concurrently. There is a small fix for it. How do you do that? In the form, there is something called show modal, this one. So I'll change the modal property from true to false. And what will happen? Now you notice that when the form is open, I can work on my Excel and open the form at the same time. Very cool, isn't it? So now you will say, Habish, how am I supposed to know such a small thing? That, you know, you went to the form and there are like 50 properties here and you have to go somewhere and make a small change. This is programming. There will be hundreds of things. And one by one, you will have to learn all these things. Okay. Do we need to save it? I'll save it in case you guys want to have a look at it. Macro-enabled workbook. Great, let's come back to Tableau. I'll open the same file on which we were working yesterday. So quick recap, everyone. Tableau is a paid tool. There's no free version. There is a free version for students, but there otherwise isn't a free version. There is something called Tableau Public, but in that you can't save your files. Your data is not secure, so I will not even consider it. Tableau visualizations are much more complex, but they're also much more flexible. That's the trade-off compared to Power BI. Tableau has been around for much longer, 17 years. It's owned by Salesforce now. The interface is very different to Microsoft applications. Fundamentally, you can do the same thing, maps and charts and all of those things. In Tableau, you have dimensions and measures. Dimensions are text, geography, and date values, and measures are any quantitative values. All the charts are here on the right side. So you have 21 charts here. If you want to create more, you can't download them. You will have to create them using formulas. Then you have different marks, label size, color, detail, tooltip. you can just drag and drop whatever you want. So we did a map. We did another map. We saw how region and segment in column and row will break my one big chart into smaller charts. Then we also saw the filter, which is similar to the slicer on Power BI. There's nothing here. Then we saw how we can work with dates. Remember, dates were fairly complicated because in dates you have two ways of representing dates. One is like this, which means you're looking at the aggregation of all the year, quarter, month, day. And this means you're looking separately at each year, quarter, month, and day. This is like the double arrow and the expand button in Power BI, right? For example, if I select the first one, this means it will show me the total Q2 of all the 4 years. But if I select this one, it will show me Q2 of 14, 15, 16, 17 separately. Okay. Then we created a scatter plot in which in analytics, we selected our cluster, right? And remember, cluster was also dragged back into my dimensional. So I just did this so that I can make another chart using that. It uses KNN, K nearest neighbors. And we also saw that which cluster is actually contributing more to the business in terms of profitability. Finally, we ended with a calculation, which is analysis, calculated field. Sorry. Let me open the one that we created, which is profit color. So we did profit color. In Tableau, there is no equal to sign. You can't. It's not a choice. You just can't. There is no equal to sign. There is no parentheses and there is no comma, right? If you want to, you can write everything in one line as well. If ends with an end, then you also have else if inside it. So we simply said if the profit is less than zero, then loss. Sum of profit less than 20 is profit, else high profit. Then I put profit color in color, and that allowed me to keep three different colors for the three different categories that I prepared, right? Any questions so far, anyone? Otherwise, we'll continue. Just wait for a moment in case anybody thinks of something. Okay, I'll take that as a no. So what we want to do now is, let me think what I want to show you. Okay, so remember we did the average per state, where I said that I want to find the total of sales for each state. Then I want to average it out for each region. I know I did it very quickly in the first session of Power BI, but I'll do it here as well. We are creating something called LOD, which is level of detail. LOD is basically, so if somebody says, why do we do LOD? Not how we do it, but why we do it. What will you say? Very simply, you will say that we need to do LOD because it allows us to create calculations at a granularity or an aggregation level within Tableau, which otherwise is not possible. Very simple, right? And let's take an example. Let's take a simple one to begin with. I'll keep my subcategory and my sales value, right? And let's make a chart. Let's sort the data. And all of you can see, there's nothing special in this. It's just basically showing us all the 17 subcategories along with the sales value, correct? Now watch this. I will click on analysis and they say create calculated field. And I'll call this my first LOT. Let's just call this subcat total, right? We will first put curly braces. That's the first thing you do in LOT, curly brackets. What do I want to say? I want to say fixed, okay? Fixed subcategory, sum of sales. So no errors. Let's see what the result looks like. I have my subcat total. Let me drag it into columns. Now you notice that you're getting the exact same result. But then what's the point? But it looks a little different, no? So this is sum of sales like this. This is sum of subcat total. So we're actually using two different things, but what do you think is happening? Anyone? See, right click, sum, average, sum, average. Something is different now. Did you see? Even if I convert this into count, not count, but if I make it the sum, please watch. If I make it the sum, it gives me 329, 342. If I make it the average, it is still showing me 329, 342. While on the other side, the average is coming as 370. What does it mean? It's getting too confusing. Wait, let me put region, okay? Let's try to do the same example we did last time.
Sir, we have fixed the formula with for only sum to calculate the only sum of sale for that particular product.
Right.
But in this case, we can calculate the average sales of that product.
Let me search for a better example. I think I'm also not taking the right example. I think this is probably, I'm expecting, you guys to get it. Wait, just give me a moment. Just think if there's some example I can show you. One moment, guys. Yeah, I think this one probably would work. Yeah, let's do this. Let me keep region and state and sales value, okay? What I want is, I want to see the value of my region, which is central, okay? Next to all the states. What is happening? If I don't keep the state, it tells me central is 499.87. Just remember this number, okay? 499. The moment I put my state in my rows, Tableau tries to help me. Tableau says, okay, Havish has put the state after the region. That means he wants to break the region value into all these smaller numbers, correct? But I don't want that. I don't want the region sales value to be broken down. I want to see the complete number. How do I do that? I want to fix that number, right? So I will create a calculator field and I'll call it fixed region LOD. Yeah, I think this would be a better example. So I'll say fixed my region and find the sum of sales. So what am I doing? I'm saying that despite the fact that the second column has the state in it, which means that the region should get filtered, I'm telling it fix the region. So don't filter it on the sales value, on the state value. So now when I put it here, just a minute. You will notice this one, very interesting, right? See what's happening. Remember, central was 499. It is showing you 499 despite the fact that we have all the states here. Now, can anybody tell me what is the advantage of doing this? Hopefully I've seen what we did, but why are we doing it? How would this help us?
So we can calculate how much percentage of sales that is coming from alienists.
This will allow you to do percentage contribution. What can you do now? Now you can divide sales by the fixed region LOD. Let's try to do that. Analysis, calculated field, we will say percentage contrib. What will this be? This will be the sum of my sales value divided by the fixed region LOD. Let's see. Cannot mix aggregate and non-LOD. Wait. Let's see if this works. Where do I put it? Let me just check. No, that will clearly not work. What am I doing wrong? So we are taking the sales value, which is all right. And then we are taking the fixed region LOD.
Sir, why sum of sales only?
Yeah, actually what happens is that these are aggregate and non-aggregate functions. So it will not work like this. Yeah. Yeah, you can't mix. So what is happening is,
why sum of sales, sir?
See, because you're not dividing the entire column by a value. No, you're dividing the total sales for the state, which means you're dividing 79,000 by the fixed region value. Okay. Just give me a moment. Something silly I'm doing. If we don't make it an aggregation, okay? Yeah, this will definitely not work. No problem, let's fix it together. So, this is definitely not working, you know, because I think my logic is correct. You know what, let me just at least give it a shot. This is what we calculate, no? Let me filter it. Sorry, let me format it. And let me make it a percentage. See, I should have a little more trust in myself. See, I don't, I'm not a Tableau expert. I'm more of a Power BI expert, but anyway, I hope you could see in this process that it is difficult, you know, LOD and all, maybe for me, it is even more so because I don't work on it a lot, but it is a difficult concept. Do you see all this confusion? What is aggregate? What is non-aggregate? Even with DAX and Power BI, you did not really have to bother with so many things, right? That it will not work, it will give an error. It doesn't work like that. It is very similar to Excel. Like here, what we are doing is, we're doing the correct thing. So we are basically taking the sum of sales, which means 79,000. Isn't 79,000 the sum of Illinois? It is, right? If I only set sales, it doesn't mean anything because sales is a column. Sales is not a number. How can you divide a column by a number? It doesn't make sense because that will result in another column. You will not get a result. For example, if my sales column has 10,000 transactions in it, if I divide each one of these transactions by the sum of fixed region LOD, what will be the result? The result will be another column. But how can I show a column as a result, right? That is the reason it needs to be an aggregation like this, right? Now, this might again be a little confusing that isn't the fixed region LOD also a fixed number? Like, why do we need to aggregate it? But that's just how it works. You know, in Tableau, you cannot mix aggregate and non-aggregate arguments. Let me quickly show this. Aggregate, non-aggregate error. Let me show it to you on the Tableau community only. See, Tableau also understands that LOD is quite complicated. So you will see these questions coming up very often. Okay, so cannot mix ag and non-ag. Okay, I'm not really sure what I'm supposed to show to you, but I just wanted to show you that this is not a peculiar problem that came in. It's very common, right? And everybody likes to explain how and why this problem happens, right? Okay. Now, let me show you the funny bit. If you really wanted this number, okay, this one, okay, what I could have also tried to do is, let me make a new sheet, subcategory, region, sales. Let me put my region here, right? Let me first show the subtotals. So analysis, totals, and then add those subtotals. So 499 comes here at the bottom. And then I say sales, quick table calculation, right? Because I want to do a quick table, just like a pivot table. And you want to find the percent of total, right? So this also gives you a form of a percentage, correct? Let me see if I can make it the percentage of only the specific region. Like right now, 1.4, it is central axis series divided by the grand total, right? Which we don't want to do. So what we want to do here is, let me see if I can compute using pain down. And axis series is 6.77%. Why am I selecting the subcategories? We were looking at the state, right? Wait. State. Illinois is 15.98. Illinois is 15.98. So basically, I have shown you how you can first do a quick table calculation percent of total and follow that up with a compute using pain down. And you get the same result. You might say, by the way, this is also difficult. Did you not see this? Because you will say, okay, Harish, we understand that you want to do a percent of total because we have done this on Excel. We can do this in Power BI. What the hell is a pain? Because this is not a term that we used in Excel on Power BI. Pain basically means this. Central is a pain right now. East is a pain right now, right? Which means that since we have two row hierarchical levels, the first level of hierarchy is called a pain. Right? That's what you have to change here. Anyway, the point is, even though I'm getting the number here without using any formulas, I would still prefer this one. And you know why? This gives me more flexibility. Like if I wanted to do another arithmetic operator on it, I could have always done that. Maybe connect it to a different data set. I could have done that. This one is what we call implicit. That means the calculation is happening implicitly inside Tableau, where I can't control the way it is being calculated. I can't tweak it. This is explicit. That means I'm controlling the exact steps. I'm first calculating the fixed region, then I'm dividing this and this, and then I'm getting the percentage contribution. So I get better control over this. Right? By the way, I don't know if you guys noticed or not, but when we put percentage contribution, let me just do it once again. By the way, this also happens. Even if you try to remove something, do you see how my measure value suddenly becomes so funny? So many things come here. This is the problem with Tableau. You know, it's a very, it has its own mind. And you will suddenly say, why the hell is it showing you D&D and quantity and profit? We never selected these things. That's just how it works. Okay. But anyway, let me show you something. Quantity says, Wait. You know, doing is one thing, teaching is a different thing altogether. Wait. Anyway, if you notice these measure names that are coming, all I wanted to show you was that because we get the ag contribution, the percentage contribution, if I remove this, right, and I have my fixed region, if I remove the fixed region also, yeah, let me explain like this. You notice these measure names go away. And suddenly you will see, but if I put my fixed region, in my text, if I double click on my fixed region, it is coming inside the table. Why is it showing measure names here? Like I said, I neither can attempt to do it in such a short span of time, nor do I think I'm the right person. Like in Power BI, I can tell you all the specifics. I can attempt to in Tableau, like if I really have to, but I don't think I'll be able to give you a very smooth answer as to why these measure names are coming. But at the very least, my hope is that you can see how much more difficult Tableau is, you know, even for these small, small things. It all looks very polished and elegant, which I agree with, but there is a lot of things happening behind the scene. Okay, let's take a 2-minute pause. Something you would like to ask? So we all do this. I've seen people with 6, 7, 10 years of experience on Tableau, and I've seen how they work. You know, I think that's a very good way to see what should you aspire to be. Like if you see the way I work on Excel, or perhaps even on Power BI, with humility, I can see I can be an inspiration where you say, oh, I want to work like him with the efficiency and the cleanliness, right? And the speed with which he works, because I've honed it. But when it comes to Tableau, I look at other people who have been working for many, many years, over a decade, and I look at how they work and, you know, how they do hit and trial, and sometimes it doesn't work, and they try different combinations and all of that. And that gives me a lot of confidence and clarity that, oh, they also do this, these things. So I think the limited learning I've had with Tableau for 1 year, less than a year, in fact, has been that do not be afraid of trying different things. If you're afraid that, no, I want to make sure my formula is going to be exactly correct before I try it, you will never make any headway. You have to get in the habit of making mistakes, trying out different combinations. Sometimes you know something will not work and it just seems to work. And then you try to figure out why did it work in the first place, right? Also, to add another layer of complication, the formatting and all is very difficult. Like if you remember, how did I format my percentage contribution? This, I had to click on percentage contribution format, and then here I had to select percentage contribution, and then I can select the formatting here. I guess this is true with every tool, like other than what we are used to, Excel, PowerPoint, Power BI for, to some, even Power BI for you guys will be fairly difficult when you guys start working on it, because everything is in a different location. Everything is called something different. Like we are so used to seeing on Excel something being called by a certain word, in Power BI it would be different. Tableau is even more so. Everything other than the fact that they are called sheets and column and rows, I don't think anything else resembles anything you have seen up till now. All right, let's look at a tool tip. So subcategory and sales, and let's make a chart. What I also want to do is I want to put something in the color. So we'll put our category, not a category, but a segment in the color. What will happen? It will become a stacked chart now. Fair enough. But I want to show this as a 100% stack. Now remember in Power BI, I showed you there was an option called 100% stack. Here you don't have an option for 100%. How do you do it? On sales, you will say quick table calculation and percentage of total. Now it does make it percentages, but you don't see the stack. You don't see the 100%. So again, you will have to go and say, compute using table down. Now this time, remember, it's not a pane, it's a table down. We don't have a pane right now. And this makes it 100%. Simple enough, right? Consumer phones is 51%. Corporate phones is 27%. And home phones is 20%. So within phones, there are three segments that I'm selling it. I want to make another chart. Let me first rotate the label. I want to make another chart which has something different on it. Okay. So on sheet number 12, we've already used the segment and the subcategory. Let's look at maybe the shipping mode. So I'll create shipping mode and sales and region and make it a tree map, which we've already done on Power BI, right? Tree map, this one. Okay, what do we want to do now? I want to connect sheet 11 with sheet 12, okay? Like a tooltip, which I showed you on Power BI. How do you do this? You have an option called tooltip here. And I will say that I want to insert another sheet as a mini chart within this one. So sheet, and then select sheet 11. Now this all looks very complicated. Like in Power BI, you don't have all this, but here you can select the width and the height here, which is the max width and the max height. Let's see how it looks. Then we'll modify it if needed. Now what happens? I can see a tree map with my region and my shipping mode. So I can see West Standard Class in the top left corner. If I want to see that within West Standard Class, what was the 100% stack chart for my segment and my subcategory, I can just take my mouse and it shows me the data like this. There's a prompt that says view is too large to show, obviously, because I've kept the width limited. So what do we do? Go back to tooltip and we can set the max width to, let's say, 700. Let's see how it looks now. Much better, but perhaps I need to do it a little bit more. Let me see if I can compress it and see if that helps. Yeah, that doesn't help either. So let's select 900. Yeah, I think that's good enough. Okay, so we have this exactly the same. No, what we did on everyone, what we did on Power BI works this exact same way. No difference, right? On format and animations, if you turn the animations on, oh, it's already turned on, but it's not, yeah, it is animating, right? Like this. So this is how you make a tooltip. Let's look at parameters. I only want to show the top 10 customers, right? So I will select my customer name, sales, and select a tree map. Now I know it looks very funny, but this is what we're doing, right? We have 793 customers with us that you can see in the bottom left corner. And Sean and Tamara Chan, Raymond, Tom, and Adrian. And as you go towards the bottom right, you notice the value decreases. It looks very nice, but I mean, I only want to see the top 10. How do you see only the top 10? Remember in Power BI, we went to filter and we selected it. Here, we also have a filter. So I'll keep my customer name in filter. And what type of filter do I want? I want to keep a top filter, which is top 10. Apply. And simple enough, you see top 10. But there's a problem. What if the user wants to see top 15? Now in Power BI, you can simply go and change the number. Here it is more difficult. You will have to come here, you will have to edit it, then you have to come here and change the number. Plus the process is not very user intuitive. It's not very polished. I want to give the user a lever. They can slide the lever left and right. And as they select bigger or smaller numbers, the tree map will also change. Let's see what we do. This time we'll create a parameter. So I'll click on the small drop down here and select create parameter. Let's call this number of customers, which is an integer between, let's say 1 and 100, right? 1 being the minimum and 100 being the maximum number of customers I want to show. I have many more. I have 793, but I think practically I probably will not need to show more than 30, right? That's it. So number of customers, integer, 1 to 30 is the range. The parameter always comes at the very end. So we have the dimension, we have the measure. Below that, we have the parameter. Right-click, show parameter. And now you notice on the right side, you can see this parameter and you can drag it. Very nice. But this is not connected to my chart right now. So on my customer name, I will edit the filter. And rather than saying top 10, I will say number of customers. So I can choose that parameter that I've created. Simple enough. And what happens now? I can drag it, right? And the number of customers shown on the tree map also changes. Any questions there?
When to use a calculated field and when to use a parameter?
Very different. A parameter is it's a parameter. It's a user input. You want the user to tell you how much he wants to see. Calculated field is a calculation. it's an arithmetic calculation, or it's a new field that you're creating. They go with each other. They're not anti each other. Parameters and calculate field in more complex calculation will be used together, not separately.
Right, sir.
Parameter is the input that the user is giving you. Like, I'm the author of the report. I'm asking the user, you tell me how much do you want? He says, I want to see 5. So I say, okay, this is 5. Calculated field means I am creating something which will enable the user to see something which is not available on the report, right? So let's look at it like this. A parameter can act like an input for a calculated field. I hope that makes sense. A parameter is something I'm taking from the user, which is an input, and then I can use it as an input for my calculated field.
Right, sir.
Okay. Let's also look at a dashboard now, simple enough. Now, rather than creating a sheet, I will set the second button, which is a new dashboard. And what do we do here? Let me first increase the size.
Sir?
Yep.
Sir, you have said that you can connect both the parameter and the calculation. Yeah, so while creating a calculated field, you can input the parameter in that box, right? We can have that.
Yeah. First, okay. The parameter comes in. Once the parameter is created, then you can use that in the calculation. Do you want to see?
So,
wait, no, hold on. Give me a moment. I think some of these are quite complicated. I want to take a simpler one. Wait. What is this? This is something different. It's not what I'm looking at. Yeah, this one. Okay. Can I show you this one? 1 second. What are we using here? Sum of highlight column. So highlight column. Yeah, I think we can look at this. Let me explain it first. What are we doing? This is not a calculation, we are doing a highlighting. I have my same data, okay? Region and columns here, everyone. What do I do? If I choose a region, you notice that column gets highlighted, right? If I select west, if I select east. So we know what we are doing. Now let me show you what we have done. What is my parameter here, everyone? Choose region to highlight is a parameter. This is not a filter, okay? Don't get confused that I've just made a filter. This is a parameter that I've taken. How have I done it? I've taken a parameter with 4 values in it, central, east, south, and west. Now this parameter needs to be sent to some calculation. So now you notice that in my highlight column, I've said that if the region is equal to the choose region to highlight, that means the parameter value, which has been selected by Havish, who's the user, is coming from here. Where is this east value going? It is going inside the calculation field, right? And then the calculation is working. It's either giving a 1 or a 0. Makes sense, everyone? So there are 2 parameters I have, subcategory and highlight. And the value coming in the parameter as an input is being used as an input in my calculated field here.
Got it, sir.
Got it? So, and this will be 99% of the time. The idea of a parameter, even though the one I showed you, they don't actually use it in conjunction with the calculation. More often than not, you would see that guys, creating a parameter only means you're telling the user, tell me what you want. He says, fine, this is what I want. But what do you do with that input? You have to use it furthermore for some other purpose, right? which will be fed into a calculation, which goes without saying, right? Like here, what I've done is I can choose the number of months I want to see, and it shows me that specific number of months like this. How is it working? These are more advanced calculations, but I first created a parameter 1 to 24 that is similar to what we did. Once I've taken the user input from the parameter, then I've created something called last 3 months, which is a calculation like this. Like I said, it's a more difficult calculation. We're doing a date diff, difference between two dates. Then I'm doing the trunk. That means from the order date, I'm only taking the month value, and then I'm taking a level of detail expression, which is my maximum from the complete data set. Like I said, don't worry about the calculation here, but this is the parameter that I've taken inside, right? How many previous months? Okay. So when we make a dashboard, it's a blank dashboard. Remember in Power BI, you can make multiple charts on a visualization on a single page. In Tableau, you first make one sheet each, having one visualization. And then you select what all you want to show on one dashboard. So let's say I want to choose my map. So I'll drag it like this. Simple enough. Below that, I want to show my cluster. So I'll drag it here. And I also want to show my profit loss like this. But right now, even now, there is no interactivity. Like if I click on Montana, I just select it. You notice the other two things are not changing, right? And let me also remove these titles and all. We don't need it. Let's get some more space to work with. You notice that I click and nothing happens. You have to explicitly tell Tableau that, yes, I have three charts here and I want to use the first one as a filter. So you click on the small dropdown and then you say, use as filter. What will happen now? Now the user can basically click on any state, let's say Colorado, and you notice it actually changes the other visualizations. Okay. Similar to Power BI. And now you see how much simpler Power BI is. So like you can just drag and drop and make something. Here you have to make a sheet each, then you have to align everything, and you're constrained by the way you can align it. Right? Then you have to define that, no, this has to be used as a filter. Power BI takes a different approach. Power BI says, you know what? Don't make multiple visuals separately and then put it together and then make a filter. Just make everything on one page. They're connected by default. And you don't have to make multiple pages. You just make one page with all the visuals on it. Right? But see, that's a trade-off. Power BI is simpler, but has lesser flexibility. Tableau is complicated, more time-consuming, but it has amazing flexibility. Like, to the point that you can't even imagine what all it can do. Questions, anyone?
So one thing that I find difficulty in is like putting all the things in the dashboard and making sure that everything is visible in Tableau.
I know that's a challenge everybody has. And you know, if you look at the Tableau gallery, you will notice that good dashboards have very little information. I mean, as in they don't have a lot of clutter. We'll just randomly look at a few of them. Let's see this. Like this is obviously very simple, but maybe like this. How many things do we have? We have one label. We have one donut chart. We have a column chart. We have an area map and we have a bar chart. I think this is the best thing you can do, no? Just look at what others are doing. And I think that will give you a lot of ideas how you can present your data. That's all I can say. I mean, there is no shortcut to that. You just have to learn small.
The one before this, could you please scroll up? So, the one after this, scroll down, please.
This one?
The next one, the air we breathe. So what is these lines, how they have made it? If you can.
These are, remember I showed you Sankey.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Let me see if I can download it. Wait. These are all calculations, guys. We can download it. Wonderful. So let me download it. Ooh. why is my phone not charging? One moment. Okay, let's see. So let me first unhide all the sheets. Okay, let's see what all he has done. The bar is okay, scatter is okay, sources is okay. Let's look at the map, right? So he has created, do you see all this, guys? Do you see the curve and the curve X and all? So he has created these Z, let's look at the calculated fields that he has. Curve X, what is it? Look, what did I tell you? Start X, longitude, degrees, sigmoids. You can't do it. Sigmoids is something very common. You will see sigmoids everywhere. Wherever there are curves, there'll be sigmoids, right? All these are calculations. This one, the one with an equal to sign. So many of them.
We have to start it from scratch. We can't tweak it.
Scratch. You can tweak it. Like, nobody's stopping you. But that would not be easy either. Like, because see, here, they haven't told you what is the order in which you created it. And I hope that all of you were able to see that in Tableau. Another challenge is that it's not just you have to put the pills in the right places. You also have to do it in the correct order. This is very important. It's not that you, if I need 10 things on a chart, it's not that you will put 10 things on the chart. You have to put it in the same order. In Power BI, that isn't the case. As long as the things are in the right place, it works. In Tableau, the order in which you put it has a big impact. The more you work with it, you will realize this. Yeah, so this is a good example to show you what I meant when I said that there's a lot of work that goes into all this. These are comments, by the way, with double slash. But it looks brilliant, doesn't it? These are also sort of clickable. Right. Some of these people will put in the effort to explain it. Like here, obviously, you would not have an explanation. You can see this, so it will describe the sheet for you. How do I increase the size? Okay. Oh-ho. So we have, what all have we used here? We have used change, curve Y, curve X, country city, category predicted. And there are points. Then this is a formula that we have calculated. Yeah, then there is this, a measure that is there, right, like this. This is describe sheet, by the way. On worksheet, you can click on describe sheet, control E, that gives you a description of the sheet. You can do this for any sheet. It helps you a little bit, not a lot though, but helps you a little bit.
So what they have done is they have taken the map, they have added the city's latitude, longitudes, as well as the database online. That is about their air, right?
Go on.
If we can change the map and select other cities with their data, then maybe we can make something out of it for India.
But then you're trying to tell me that, Havish, I have a solution. I'm trying to create a problem. You can't go to the client and say, see, I can only make this chart. You give me the data that fits this chart.
Yeah, makes sense.
You know what I'm saying, right?
Mm-hmm.
See, from a student perspective, this is very nice. You don't care. You just have to present something good to the faculty or in a live project or in a competition. You can do whatever you want. The problem is that realistically, think about it. No, it's common sense. It doesn't work like this. I love it. I love this one. I also love it. But I don't see myself using it anywhere, right? Like even if I think of using a bit of it, I can't, because my clients will have very different types of data sets, right? And like I said, the tweaking, just ignore the tweaking bit. Unless you learn it from the scratch, believe me, tweaking doesn't work on Tableau. It just wouldn't. It just sounds nice that we can tweak it, but you just can't. You know, and that's the irony. People feel tweaking is done by guys who are beginners and, you know, who don't know a lot. I say tweaking is done by people who are already professionals. Like if I have been given a code, a 250 line code by somebody, I can tweak it because I already am very, very good at it. A beginner would not even know what to do with it, right? So always think of it as inverse. Tweaks, modifications, cutting corners are done by people who are already very experienced because they know how to cut corners. A beginner will never be able to cut corners because he doesn't know what to do, what not to do. Right? Yeah. Good. You can just see what all I have prepared, like that will at least help you understand. Like, I have a lot of stuff here. Just see the variety of charts that I have, right? So I have a heat map, then I have these some colored lines and all, running totals. Then I have these, you know, I've tried to make a Google-like map with the area under the curve. Profit sales comparison, then we had without numbers. Of course, we have done this. Yeah, these are comparison charts, right? So we call this lollipop charts, this one. These are dumbbell charts. These are tornado charts for comparison. These are lollipop, right? Financial analysis use this a lot. Then you have the donut charts. These are called bump charts, BOMP, which shows ranks. Then these are spark lines, which have a dot at the end, look very nice, but they require a calculation. All of these require calculations, most of these at least. Some of this we have done. This is all is okay. This is nice. This is comparison. So I'm comparing one state, which is New Jersey, to all the others. Looks very cool, right? Like, it tells me how many states are more than New Jersey, how many states are lesser. Like, I can select any state I want and it will compare it for me. Just see how beautiful this looks.
What is a chart called, sir?
How did you make this? It's just a bar chart. Just a bar chart with some calculations in it, like this state diff that I've calculated. So the state diff is basically a long calculation where I'm basically creating different combinations. So I'm saying either it is earning more or it is earning less, or it is exactly what we're looking at. So less, more, and same, right? But this is quite complicated. It's not just a basic if statement. Like, here you have this ATTR, which is called attributes. I won't get into the deep end, but see, this is a parameter. Do you see this? Compare sales with, which is what the user is choosing, which state to compare against. But this is a very good example. I would say an intermediate level example. Then what else? Yeah, these are also nice. This also takes a little bit of time, so I will not cover this now. They basically are icons that you can put in, and you can put your own icons here. You can even color it if you want to. Then what else? Yeah, these are waterfall charts. Then yeah, this is very nice. Watch this. Why is it not working? Wait, did I do something wrong? Yeah, very cool, right? I can actually click on a subcategory and it will do a Google search for that subcategory. So these are called actions where you can, let me at least show you how it looks. So, I'm sorry, just a moment. Oh, damn it, where's my action? Wait. So data worksheet, dashboard format, actions, control shift D. So basically I've set an action saying that there is a hyperlink that I've created. So when somebody selects a subcategory, what will happen? Let me edit it, show it to you. So when somebody edits a subcategory, it will go to this URL. But if you notice, what is happening is there is a part of the URL that I've kept as a parameter, which is a subcategory. You understand the process, no? I choose phones, I click on phones, that becomes a user input. That input is what I'm putting inside the query, inside the queue. But for this, you need to know a little bit of HTML, right? How the web works. But it's not, again, like I said, nothing is rocket science. You can learn anything you want. It's just that you will have to put some time and effort. For example, when I search for something on Google, let's say Harish, do you notice this search bar at the top? So what is happening? This is my search query, this part, right? Which is coming after the Q and equal to. So that's what I'm doing. I'm basically making that a parameter which the user can input from their own side, right? That's really nice. It looks super cool. And a lot of different ways in which this can help you presenting your data. These are also fairly complex calculations. This is using something called like, you know, this is like a BCG quadrant. So there are four quadrants on the map. What is interesting here is that you can actually create different colors. And how we do that is we create quadrant colors, right? And we use a window operation here. Something called window underscore median. That's an inbuilt function that allows you to identify the cutoff point inside the window. So you can define four quadrants like this. Right. Again, not difficult. It's just that you'll have to spend some time understanding all of this. Yeah, I think that's all. So as you can see, I don't really do a lot with Tableau. Even with Power BI, if you notice, my dashboards on the website are good, but they're not like the best. The reason is because I'm not a data visualization guy, right? Like I do it, but I mostly work with C-level, right? And C-level, it's very simple dashboards that I have to create. I can if the need comes, but that's not an area where I want to invest my time.
Yeah. Sir, can you show that part again?
Which one?
That storage Google link part.
That one? Sure.
Just before this.
How when I click on the subcategory, the page opens, is it?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Sure. Sir, how did you manage to put that result in a floating window? In a dashboard window?
Let me open it. Hold on.
Mm-hmm. Sir, can you send this file if it is possible?
This one, the one I have?
Yes, sir.
I'm thinking. I can't send you this one because there are a few which are things that I have done just for me, which I've not seen other people do, or very few people do. But let me see if I can send you a different one, right? Which already has some solid. By the way, you don't really need me. You know why? I think you should be able to get it online. Just give me 1 minute. Andy Kriebel, right? Just give me a moment. I think you can download the Tableau workbook here, if I'm not mistaken. How do I download it? Yeah, guys, you can download it from here. He has covered even more than I have covered, right? Let me show you what all is there. But I don't think you can open the file that I'll be sending because you guys will have a student license. And if I'm not mistaken, maybe you can, you'll have to check. I'm not sure if you can open these files with a student license or not. I have a feeling, I have a suspicion that you can't. So if you notice here, guys, see, he's given everything. You have a no access bar chart, lollipop, month, stacked. He's explained everything. I mean, he hasn't explained it, but he has given everything. There's a lot, even these ones, right? And you can see all the calculations. There's nothing this is the dashboard, obviously, but there's nothing hidden from you. Like these are small multiples. This is a little more difficult though. I'm not sure what has he used differently, but anyway, you can have a look at it. So I'll share the link with you. You can simply download it. Control C. And now do you realize why I keep on telling you guys know how to search and know where to search, and you have to know what all is there available. If you don't even know that all these things are there, I mean, nobody's going to help you with that, right? Yeah, I've sent that. See, guys, what I've done is, before I show you the process, let's understand what we're doing. I click. That means Tableau is able to identify that Havish has chosen chairs as the category. That becomes a search term, the query term. What am I doing after that? In my actions, which I seem to have lost again, no, worksheet actions. that? Where did my action go? Oh, yeah. So what I'm doing is I'm saying that this is the URL, which you can just copy and paste from the internet, right? The entire thing. But this part, right? The query term has to be the field that you're selecting from here. Right? Just look at it and see if it makes sense.
Yes, sir.
Simple. Let's not overcomplicate it, right? I'm on a dashboard. What am I doing? I'm selecting subcat for dashboard. That means which charts selected value am I taking, which is subcat for dashboard. There's only one chart. When the user hovers, I can even change it to hover. That will look even better. Now you notice I don't even have to click anywhere. I can just, in fact, let me also increase the size so it looks better. How do I do that? Can we reduce this? And just a moment. So 1920 by 1080. Yeah, I think that's much better. That's cool. Yeah, I think that's much better. So if you notice, I can just take my mouse. I don't even have to click now, right? Very fluid, isn't it? And I'm sure all of you can think of multiple ways in which this can help you. Not for a Google search, but maybe you can connect to, I don't know, whatever it is, maybe a Wikipedia page or stock market data or something like that. And believe me, what I'm showing you now, the more you start working with Tableau, you will find 500 such different things, actions and stories and this and that, custom visuals. Tableau is very old and people have done amazing things with it. But yes, just remember, one part of your learning is to learn what all is there, the tools and the techniques. The other is to start building your own formulas and all, right? So learning calculations are super important, both in Power BI using DAX and in Tableau, basic calculations. I'm not referring to LOD. Level of detail is much more complicated and that will come later. But to begin with, at least start with basic calculations. Excellent, guys. That's all from my side. Anything you would like to ask? Not just on Tableau, but otherwise as well. Sorry, I'll just check my message once. Yeah.
So there was this gradient thing on PowerPoint that you were told that you'd show us.
Gradient?
Something of that sort. I don't particularly
know. No problem. I'll do that. Insert, shapes, arrow. Let's say I want to show a growth, right? But I want to have different colors inside it. So right click, format, shape, go to fill, select a gradient fill, and then you can put different colors in it. Just watch. Right now I have two colors, white and blue, so I can move it around. But the direction is top to bottom. I want it to be left to right. So we can change the direction from left to right. Just a moment. With this one. Let me just put some different colors here. Otherwise, we will not even know what's happening. So on the left, you want a red. And on the right, you want a green like this. Let me move it. So the red comes later. The green comes in the beginning. And we also want to keep one more color, maybe a yellow like this.
I guess the direction is not right. It's
yeah, I'll just do that. One second. Yeah. That's all gradients are like this. The rest is hidden trial, this one.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, we do a lot of statistic work using SPSS, factor analysis, cluster analysis, like that. I guess Tableau doesn't support all these more statistical modeling kind of things, or does it?
Why would it? Why does it need to? When you already have IBM SPSS, why would Tableau want to? Like SPSS doesn't try to do data visualization, correct? Like Tableau. So why would Tableau want to do statistic analysis like SPSS. They're different tools, simple.
Yeah.
Right? Like if you have done coding on SPSS, if you've done script, they have a different language, and academicians and researchers have been using that for many, many years, and they will continue to use it. There really is no need for Tableau and Power BI to enter a different area. And the user of Tableau and Power BI is not really intending to do all of this work. If a user wants to do both data visualization and cluster analysis, they will use both tools. They will not use one tool. See, there's no one tool in the world that can do everything. I mean, it doesn't make sense, right? You need specialized tools for specialized things.
Yes, sir.
Like for that matter, I can even do regression on Excel, but would I do it? Does it make sense? No, I would prefer to do regression on SPSS correct because I get so many options, logistic and stepwise, backward, forward, things like that, encoding variables and all that. Why would I want to do it on Excel? Even though Excel has it, right? So that's the point. Like Excel also has charts. Then why are you guys learning Power BI and Tableau? Why don't you continue working on Excel? Because these tools are specialized towards data visualization. These are BI tools, business intelligence tools, not statistical tools.
Sir, does Informatica has any relevance in today's business?
I think it has just disappeared over the years. Let me just check. I haven't heard of anybody mentioning Informatica for a very long time.
I remember in 2016, Infosys used to train their using Informatica.
It's still there. Informatica is still there. It's very large. It's a billion-dollar company in 2014. But I think it's over time, I'm not sure if it has been on the upswing or not. Wait. I don't know, I have to search. I can't seem to find anything right there. I haven't seen, the only thing I can tell you is that with all the clients that I work with, I have seen nobody who works on Informatica. Maybe there are some specific sectors and all that work on it.
Yes.
Like they do, like 85 Fortune 100 companies are working on it, but their revenue is not commensurate with that. Do you understand what I mean?
Yes.
On one side, we are saying that 85 out of 100 are using it, but then it's only $1 billion, which is not really a lot, which just goes to show you that I don't think it's in the same space as Power BI and Tableau, right? Because it's not in the same magic quadrant weight. Yeah, so it's in data integration, enterprise integration, master data management, data quality, and metadata. Yeah, I don't think it's a BI tool anymore. I think it does different things from what I can see. I wouldn't know. I mean, I can only tell you from the little bit that I have heard of. I haven't heard of it in the spaces that I work with. Right? But, you know, it's definitely an enterprise tool. That's not an area that I work in. Anyway, that's not bothersome.
Uh-huh. Sir, a little bit about career growth in data analytics and consulting.
Consulting is something different. It has nothing to do with data analytics. In data analytics, I, again, have limited experience because not limited experience, but there's only so much I can tell you. See, I have been running my own firms for a while now, right? For 2016 mid, I've been running my own firm. So I haven't really applied for a job since 2013. Lucky me. So the point is that I'm not really sure what type of jobs are there and, you know, what do they ask in interviews and what does the job profile look like? Of course, I have conversations with people. And what I see people asking now is that basic Python and intermediate Power BI. I think most data analyst profiles are mentioning these two things. Is what I've heard from a lot of people who come to me. But just be nimble and make sure to learn as per the trend, right? Like right now, Power BI, Tableau, all is at a peak, and it is expected to be at least for the next 5-10 years. Then we'll see, once AI and ML becomes an even bigger part, maybe the way we use these tools might fundamentally change, right? Maybe the tools will still exist, but the way we use it will completely change. Like there's a company called alpha.ai. You guys can search for it, alpha with a double A, right? They do voice-based insights. So they do AI-assisted analytics using voice. Let me show you how it works. Like you can just ask, what is our monthly phone sales and show profit for California? So this is a voice. You can use Alexa or Google for it. And it basically doesn't just give you a dashboard. It actually gives you insights. It says February 2018 has the highest sale in comparison to others with this much and all this, right? So there's a guy called Saurabh Moody. Who has been running this for, he's an ex-Microsoft. He's here, we are friends. He runs this firm in Noida. And these guys are doing very well. He has been with Microsoft for many, many years. And he basically has been running this startup for a while. They're doing about 30 crores per year now. And they have very big plans now, Pepsi and SBI and all that. So they want to build, his vision is to build AI voice analyst. He sees a lot of future in not just chatbots, but artificial intelligence using voice. So they have built their own engine that can parse natural language speech into text and then create insights from it. You know, so that's the point. I mean, there'll be a lot of different trends coming in. I told you that NIME is going to become very important going forward. Like even I haven't had the opportunity of working on it. I really, really want to take out the time and do it. PwC EY is focusing on this quite a lot. And I really want to be ahead of others. And I so far haven't had the opportunity of doing this. I think this is something you really should work on. Just a little bit of basic things, you know, Excel, learn as much as you can. It will help you no matter what you do and where you are. Power BI is also a must. Learn a little bit of programming. Maybe Python is a good starting point. You don't need to learn other things. I think that's about it. I think don't take it too seriously. Like right now, so early in your career, like after spending so many years in the industry, I also don't know what will happen 1 year, 2 years later. How can you guys plan for the next 5 years? It doesn't make any sense. Technology is so rapidly advancing. I know we say this, we have been saying this for 30 years, but my point is that it really is. It's exponentially advancing, right? And these changes like AI and ML, they haven't really happened in the last 10, 15 years. This is a very big change. Like if you look at Excel in the last 20 years, it hasn't really changed a lot. Same charts, similar formulas, functions, this, that. People don't really work very differently. And I know this because when a CTO speaks to me, he says, Harish, when I used to be an engineer 20 years back, I don't really see much change in the way we guys work, right? It just looks more polished, but the work remains the same. But this last maybe 2-3 years, there's been a lot of change. One big change is that Python has become something for everyone. You know, a lot of people are learning it. Programming is something that the government is also paying a lot of emphasis on. Power BI has made a huge shift. I think that's the right middle ground. It's not hardcore, there's not hardcore coding, but it is that bridge between SQL and Excel. Like SQL is hardcore IT, Excel is Excel, but that Power Query and DAX is a bridge between it. And I think auto ML, auto AI is going to play a big part. Anyway, that's the landscape. In terms of what you guys should be doing, very clear. Excel, Power BI, a little bit of Python, and maybe NIME and all you can do a little bit. And parallelly, also do some courses on, design thinking, actual design, typography, use of colors, storytelling. You will never, if you want to be a good consultant, you have to learn the soft aspects as well, right? Only the technical skills is not going to help you. So just keep that in mind.
Sure, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. What else? So I'll be sharing an assignment with all of you. And like I said earlier, I'll be sharing a data set, maybe with some problem statements, maybe without. I don't know. I haven't decided. You guys can, I'll share the certificates tomorrow, right? You guys have attended and you have learned. That's good for me. I'm comfortable giving the certificate. The point is, I would like all of you to work on the assignment. Maybe you do it after you do the course. I leave that up to you. But, send it, because whatever feedback I give will help. It will not be the only thing you need, but it will definitely add on to your learning, right? I'll put it like that. Also, that offer is still open on the Excel bundle. I don't want to pitch too hard, but because it's a limited offer. So in case you're interested, please make sure to, take a call. If you don't want to buy, that's okay. But if you do want to get the Excel bundle, I think I've given it a 400, if I'm not mistaken, to you guys. So there's a flash sale that is going on. So all the courses for 500 is for the general audience and 400 for you guys. If you are interested in specifically Power BI and Tableau at a more advanced level, then you can just see my content on YouTube and take a call. And I'm just sort of building these. I'm still not uploaded it. So what I'm doing is I'm building this one. So I'm building a definitive analytics bundle, which has a lot of Power Query in it, like 50 times more than what I covered. Then there is basic intermediate Power BI, and there is also DAX, a special course just on DAX, right? And then of course, Tableau also, we have data visualization, basic intermediate, and then an advanced calculation on LOD, where I've covered more than 15 case studies. So this is a pack which is there. I'll probably share it with Tanya and she can send it forward to you. So if you're interested, just let me know. If maybe 10, 15 of you are interested, then I can give you guys a group discount or something. Two of the courses I've already shared, the basic ones. If you want the advanced ones, just let me know and I'll work something out.
The one that you are offering us at 400, the videos are for lifetime, or do they have applicability of 1 year,
lifetime.
This one?
Lifetime.
Right, so yep. Please share this with Tanya, right?
I'll do that. Great, guys. I think it was wonderful having all of you for over a week. We covered a lot. Many more questions came up, which is good, right? It's good to have more questions coming up. That means that you're thinking and talking and discussing. Data analysis, the area is, an ocean. There's a lot that will continue to happen. And we're in the same boat, you and me. I maybe just have a few years of head start. The point here is that it's not definite that, this is what you have to learn and this is the timeline. It's a moving target. We look at the trends of the market and we keep on pivoting ourselves. 2 years back, I was not focused on Power BI, and now I am. 6 months back, I was not focused on Tableau, now I am. 6 months back, I was not focused on DAX, now I am, because I see that my projects require me to work on DAX. I have also started learning TypeScript, like I mentioned to you, because I feel it is very important. I'm also focusing a lot on R, because I expect to teach at some colleges going forward. And because R is a part of the curriculum, I have to know R as well. I can't just teach Python. That's what I'm saying. If you talk to me after 3 month intervals, I'll say different things. Not because I don't have clarity of what I'm doing, but because requirements keep on changing. Same with you. What career path should you follow? Take a call, whether you want to be in data or not. If you want to be in data, then learn that it's not a fixed thing. You have to get in the habit of keeping on upskilling yourself. Like if you're in marketing, you don't have to learn something more every 6 months, no? You just have to work and work and work if you're in product management or branding, sales category. Same with HR and finance. Data is very different. Data is like you're a professional, like you're a lawyer or you're a doctor, which means that you have to keep yourself up to date with what all is happening in the market. It's very important. Great, that's all from my side. If you have any questions, you can connect with me even individually. Tanya can share my number with all of you. So feel free to drop me a message or give me a call or connect on LinkedIn. The best mode would be obviously to either get on a call around 10 to 12 p.m. most of the days, or you can just send me an email and we can always connect. Right. Great, guys. That's all from my side. All the very best.
Sir, thank you so